this is a time when we're able to come together to comfort one another. And death is never easy. And to have the support of everyone is very much appreciated. So again, thank everyone for coming. And we'd like to open the funeral discourse with a word of prayer. And Brother Oakley will do that for us, please.
Our loving Father, Jehovah, we do approach you this afternoon with sad hearts because of the loss of a dear friend, family member. Brings grief to us. We pray, Heavenly Father, though, that your spirit will be with us here this day and with Brother Nash as he delivers to us some encouraging information that will give us some consolation, some comfort, and to look forward to a bright hope as well, where we may be able to see our dear brother Jim again. We pray that your spirit will be with us then. We offer this prayer in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. J. Moellendorf was a man of faith, and there was something different about him. You probably recognize that in your own personal relationship with him. He was a unique man. But Jehovah God also saw him as a unique individual. And here's the reason why. In Malachi chapter 3, God looks for something in the heart of each individual on the planet. And when he sees something good, he takes note of it. In Malachi chapter 3, verse 18, talking about Jehovah or his people, and you will again see the distinction between a righteous man, a righteous person, and a wicked person, between one serving God and one not serving him. Jay wanted to use his life helping others, serving God, and he did a good job with that. I'd like to read with you just a few things that were in his obituary. And you all know that Dr. James J. Moellendorf was 64 years old when he passed away. And he died on Sunday morning, March 26, 2017. He was born February 13, 1953 in Antigo, to the son of late George and Tabea Moellendorf. And Jay was known to family and friends. And every one of us know J. Moellendorf was very family-oriented. He loved his family. He graduated from Antigo High School in 1971, and he was class valedictorian. His sister told me before, as we were talking, that when he was 5 years old, most people were watching cartoons, but what was Jay doing? Reading an encyclopedia. So he was different. The only thing I did with encyclopedias when I was that age was make bridges and roll trucks over them. But he was a different sort. And we came to really love him because of what he was. He was an accomplished photographer. He operated his own photography business until eventually he followed in the footsteps of his older brother and his father, and got involved in the tradition of chiropractic medicine. We know he graduated from Palmer College of Chiropractic in Davenport, Ohio in 1983. He received his doctorate of naturopathy in 1986 from the Trinity School of Natural Health. And then he came to Sturgeon Bay to take over the practice of Dr. Zimmer. Of course, you know, he enjoyed sharing his knowledge. He was a speaker for various chiropractic conferences across the country, and he published 2 books. But that only tells you just a thumbnail of the man. You and I have many personal stories that we can't share with everyone, but we do keep them tucked away in our hearts. And we appreciated our relationship with J. Moellendorf. In December 22, 1984, he married Sharon Delsart in Sturgeon Bay. And he was, of course, a member of this congregation. But he fully loved sharing not just his knowledge of health, but also the knowledge of the Bible with others. And he was a person that was believable. When you looked at his face and his eyes, you could sense his sincerity. And you said, okay, I'll give this man maybe a minute of my time. And that's the way the community cared for him. They were willing to listen to him. They respected him because he was willing to listen to the community, and he respected the community. He wasn't a respecter of men. Didn't matter who you were. Didn't matter your background. He wanted to help you. And again, a uniqueness about Brother Moellendorf. He survived by, of course, Sharon, two children, Pamela and Matthew. Pamela's married to Richard. And also, he has a brother, John Moellendorf, and his wife, Carol. And then we have two sisters, Faye Tuot and Calvin, the husband. And then Beverly Patelko and Roger, the husband. They're from Elk Grove, Illinois. Of course, we can't mention everyone's name that are here today. But we do appreciate every one of you coming. It helps us to grasp this idea of Jay's death. And it's beneficial for us to be together because we need comfort. And we're going to try to get a little bit more comfort with a brief interview. Brother Roberts is going to help us with answering three questions about Jay and the positive effect that he had on the congregation and on others. First of all, Brother Roberts, we said that Jay was a man of faith. Can you tell us from your point of view how he lived his faith?
Well, in the congregation here, Jay was quite a trustworthy person to have around, I would say, for one thing. When he was asked to do anything in the congregation, he willingly did it, which is, I think, a great quality. In today's world, there are not a lot of willing people to do things on a volunteer basis, but he always did what he could, and he did it well. Maybe an example, a couple examples of that are, of course, with our ministry, we're very organized with, for instance, our congregation with Door County, and it's broken down into the smaller territories. And Jay was our territory servant for a lot of years, and you never had to worry about whether they were going to be organized. They were always perfect. And then he did our accounts for a while here, and he was very trustworthy. Anytime we did an audit, we never had to worry that there was going to be something wrong with the accounts. They're always perfect. And that's always kind of to me, was always personally a really great thing. When there was an audit, I never had to worry because that stuff, it's a good thing I wasn't in charge of it because it always confused me. But he always had it just meticulously perfect and appreciated that about him very much. So he always did what he was asked and always did it very willingly and very well. That was nice. But I think the biggest thing that really came to my mind when we were talking about this before was, he was very generous. And I don't know if everybody even knows that. I know there's some who personally know that because I believe that when there were some that struggled at times, financially maybe or materially, whatever you want to call it, I think Jay was one that always helped out. And he never tooted his horn about it. But I believe that he was a very generous man, and I think that shows a real good Christian quality about him that he had, for sure. Yeah.
He put his faith in action. Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. Well, another question. How did you see Jay manifesting his spiritual progress over the years?
Well, there is no doubt that the ministry was very precious to his family. The hours that they have donated trying to teach people what the Bible really says. And Jay supported his family in that. Through the years, they donated full-time hours. His family did. His wife, the ministry is very precious to Sharon, and Jay supported her in that. The vehicles, the gas, whatever financially it costs, the hours he spent with her doing that work, I think that just, that really says something, a wonderful thing about him.
Nice, thank you very much. And Pamela wrote a little note about the effect her father had on her life, mm-hmm. You know, his patience, his steady training. And Matthew and him, of course, were joined at the hip. So, and what effect did Jay's training have on his children that you could observe?
Well, I think that's pretty evident. You look at Pamela and Matthew, they're wonderful members of society, not just the congregation, but citizens. They're honest like their dad was. They have good moral character and qualities about them. They have the same desire to help others. And so I think Pamela and Matthew are probably his greatest letters of recommendation, you could say, for sure. They're wonderful people. He did that, and it takes a lot nowadays to raise kids that have those kind of qualities. And he was successful, clearly successful parent, him and Sharon.
Yeah, Sharon and Jay did a beautiful job. Thank you very much for that. And we know that you all have other things that impressed you too about our brother Jay Moellendorf. But it's one thing to talk about the man. Right now, though, you and I, we need a little comfort. It's a sad time. Even if we have a Bible-based hope, it's a sad time. Jesus was sad when he lost his friend Lazarus. Look at John chapter 11. I always marvel at this account because it just is something that really touches my heart. Jesus knew Lazarus was going to die. And in fact, he told his disciples that, but he likened death to a sleep. And notice in John 11:11, it says, after he, that's Jesus, said these things, he added, Lazarus, our friend, has fallen asleep, but I am traveling there to awaken him. The disciples then said to him, Lord, if he's sleeping, he'll get well. Jesus, however, had spoken about his death, but they imagined he was speaking about taking rest and sleep. Then Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus has died. And I rejoice for your sake that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. So you can imagine Jesus and his apostles going down to Bethany. And he meets Martha. That's one of Lazarus' sisters. And look at the first thing that he says in verse 20. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, he went to meet him. But Mary, that's Lazarus' other sister, kept sitting at home. Martha then said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Can you imagine how that must have hit Jesus? Not thanks for coming, but just, why weren't you here earlier so my brother didn't die? But Jesus took it all in stride. And notice what he said in verse 23. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise. Martha said to him, I know he'll rise in the resurrection on the last day. But Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who exercises faith in me, even though he dies, will come to life. And everyone who is living and exercises faith in me will never die at all. Do you believe this? That's a penetrating question. Do you believe this? Some feel that, well, the resurrection hope, the Bible's comfort, is for weak minds. If you can't accept the reality that you're going to die, well, you can believe in the Bible's hope. But Mary and Martha were different. And notice what they said in verse 27. This is Martha continuing. She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I have believed that you're the Christ, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." And then she went off to talk to Mary. Well, when Mary came, notice what happened in verse 31. When the Jews who were with Mary in the house, consoling her, saw her get up quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Well, when Mary arrived where Jesus was and caught sight of him, she fell at his feet and said to him, notice what she said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Can you imagine Jesus saying, "Well, I just heard that from Martha, and now I'm hearing it from you." But he was not upset with that. That it tugged at his heart. It tugged at his heart. And so, look at what happened. When Jesus saw her, that's Mary, weeping, and the Jews who had come with her weeping, he groaned within himself and became troubled. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus gave way to tears. So if you have given way to tears over the death of J. Moellendorf, it's not a sign of weakness. It's simply a sign of the depth of feelings that you had for this very respected man. So it's understandable if you and I weep. The Lord wept, even though he knew he was going to resurrect Lazarus soon. But there's an interesting comment. In our website, you may have already looked at this. On the study edition of the New World Translation, there's a study note in Mark chapter 7, verse 34. And if you want to look at that, the smaller version of the Bible doesn't have it, but the study edition does with the study notes. In verse 34, Jesus was going to heal a man who was deaf and had a speech impediment. And look at what verse 33 and 34 says. He, Jesus, took the deaf man aside privately, away from the crowd. Then he put his fingers into the man's ears, and after spitting, he touched his tongue. And looking up into heaven, this is Jesus, he sighed deeply and said to him, "Ephrathah," that is, "be opened." Well, listen to what the footnote says, Sharon. Under "sighed deeply," it says, Mark often records Jesus' feelings, perhaps as related to Mark by Peter, a man of deep emotion. This verb about sighing deeply may describe a prayerful sigh or groan, reflecting Jesus' sympathy for the man, or even Jesus' pain over the suffering of all humans. Now, it took us to Romans chapter 8. Look at Romans 8. Because right now we're suffering. We need a little comfort. And Romans 8, verse 22 says, "For we know that all creation keeps on groaning together and being in pain together until now." But this gave us insight into Jesus' personality. It helps us to see that Jesus is determined to do something about sin and death. Jehovah God is determined, resolved to do something about sin and death. And while we groan together, we're in pain together, we look forward to that time when we'll be set free from sin and death. Is that just something to soothe you? Or is it reality from the Bible? Because you and I haven't experienced a resurrection like Jesus resurrected Lazarus. What guarantee do you and I have from the Bible that that's going to be true? Otherwise, our faith is just a belief. It's not based on any fact. Well, look at what 1 Corinthians tells us. In 1 Corinthians 15, this is the reason why you can put confidence in the resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 22, "For just as in Adam all are dying, so also in the Christ all will be made alive. But each one in his proper order, Christ the firstfruits, afterward those who belong to the Christ during his presence." So God has always been an orderly God. He's a God who does things just right. So do you see how he plans on restoring things back again? Well, he resurrected his son. He put him in charge of the kingdom in heaven. But then he's going to resurrect 144,000 to be rulers with Jesus from the heavens over the earth. And after that, those from Abel to J. Moellendorf are going to be able to be resurrected to a righteous new world. You remember the question Jesus asked Martha? Do you believe this? Well, if you have doubts, don't just not think about them. Don't just wish them away. Study the Bible. See why Jehovah wanted to resurrect his son. See why Jehovah had his son die for mankind. The explanation is clear and it's logical. But we have to come to grips with one thing. The dead are really dead. And that's what Ecclesiastes 9 tells us. And look at Ecclesiastes 9, please. In verse 5, King Solomon said, "For the living know that they will die." Now, you and I can believe that. You and I know that we could die, like Jay, could be very prematurely, or we could be suffering right now with a prolonged terminal illness. We know we can die because we're living. But look what else it says. The living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing at all. In other words, there's a difference between the two. Living, yes, I know I'm going to die. The dead, they don't know they're dead. They don't have any consciousness. Look as the scripture continues. "Nor do they have any more reward, because all memory of them is forgotten." In verse 10, "Whatever your hand finds to do, do with all your might. For there is no work, nor planning, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave where you're going." So you remember how Jay enjoyed restoring people's health? He can no longer do that. You know you can't go to his office anymore to get an adjustment, to get some treatment. So we're going to miss him for that, but for many other reasons. But Jay doesn't know that he's not going to be able to go to his office. He's unaware of things. He's dead, hoping for a resurrection. But was his faith in God misplaced? Did somehow he just live a lie? You know, poor soul, Jay, he was a good man, but he was so misguided. Well, look at what the Bible has to say. In Job 14, Job was stricken with a severe illness, and he hurt so much, he just wanted to die. But notice this confidence that he had. In Job 14 and 15, he asked a question, "If a man dies, can he live again? I will wait all the days of my compulsory service until my relief comes." So Job felt, well, my time in the grave is like my compulsory service. I got to do my time. I can't get out of it. And that's the way it is with all those in the grave. They can't bring themselves back to life. They can't have themselves stand up again, so they're stuck in the grave. But notice what the end of the verse said, until my relief comes. In verse 15, you will call in the resurrection. You, Jehovah God, will call, and I will answer you. You will long for the work of your hands. So you know how you and I like to work? Jay was a worker. He loved to work. He couldn't wait to go to work. He enjoyed using his hands to help others, to restore the health of others. Jehovah has that same viewpoint, just to a much larger degree. Jehovah cannot wait to use his hands, his abilities, to raise the dead. Now, you and I have an option. We can believe what the Bible says, or we can say, well, that's nice, but I think I'm just going to be dead and be dead forever. Well, don't miss out on this marvelous promise that God has put in his word, the Bible. He wants us to get to know him, because one thing he does know is life is just far too short. It's just unfair. Look at what Ecclesiastes 9 says. Now tell me if you don't see this to be the case with J. Moellendorf. Ecclesiastes 9, verse 11. Now again, this is wise King Solomon. He says, I've seen something further under the sun, that the swift do not always win the race. Now you and I know that. Nor do the mighty win the battle. We know that. Nor do the wise always have the food. Well, that's true. Nor do the intelligent always have the riches. Nor do those with knowledge always have success. Well, why? Because time and unexpected events overtake them all. Now, you and I can definitely relate to that as well, can't we? We know things happen in life that's unfair. This cutting short of Jay's life was not fair. It was an unexpected event. And it overtook him. And he's not rising up now. Not without Jehovah's help. But remember what Jesus told Martha? Martha, I'm the resurrection and the life. So he knew that Jehovah God was going to use him to restore mankind. Now, Jay had restorative power. He knew how to help in a limited way people's infirmities. But if you compare our dear brother Jay with the restorative power of God, they just don't match. Jehovah is far, far superior in restorative power. So when we think about Jehovah, we can't limit him to the way we limit other humans, or even ourselves. If you have that thought in your mind, try to nudge it out, because the Bible teaches us that God is almighty, yes, that he's all-powerful, yes, but it also teaches us that he has a yearning to use that restorative power again. So right now we're just thinking about dear brother Jay. But there are other family members that you and I have lost, and we want them back with us. We know it's not fair. They were snatched away from us. Now, we have that sense of injustice. How much more so does Jehovah and Jesus have it? It's not fair. So Jehovah and Jesus, they went together working in creating mankind, and then they went together working to restore mankind. What a team. God and his son, Jesus Christ. You couldn't have a better team than those two. And they're going to see what they started to its finish. Well, what scripture could you wrap your mind around with that? Look at Isaiah 55. God is going to finish his will, his purpose for the earth. He purposed it to be filled with righteous men and women from Adam and Eve. Well, after that rebellion, Jehovah had to work around the rebellion so that he could still get his will done. And look what guarantee it is. Isaiah 55. verse 10 and 11. For just as the rain and the snow pour down from heaven and do not return there until they saturate the earth, making it produce and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Now, you and I can get that, especially in this beautiful county of Door County. We know the power of the rain, the power of the soil. But God used that illustration to say this in verse 11. So my word that goes out of my mouth will be. It will not return to me without results, but it will certainly accomplish whatever is my delight. So what is God's delight for the earth? To have it a paradise. It's not that way now. He's going to have to restore it. But it's also his delight to have people like you and me populate the earth from every corner of it. You and I have a wonderful prospect if we get to know Jehovah better. But in the meantime, if you ever thought that you were unworthy of God's love, because some of us do, we've been through a lot in life personally. We've hurt personally. In conclusion, please take to heart this scripture. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, look at the expansiveness of God's love. 1 Timothy 2, 3 and 4. This is fine and acceptable in the sight of our Savior God, whose will is that all sorts of people should be saved and come to an accurate knowledge of truth. That's why Jay didn't hate people. He knew God wanted all sorts of people to get saved. So he put himself out for all sorts of people. He was not partial. You and I, we're learning the same thing, aren't we? We're trying to display impartiality in a very partial world. It's a struggle for us. But Jay did it until his last day. And Jay's family's doing it. And we want to join with him. Just the way Jehovah and Jesus are together, we want to stand right by their side and show that we too believe God is a Savior of all sorts of men. And we do that by living our lives by our faith. So may all of us look to Jehovah for strength. Sharon, you've been strong so far, but you may have ups and downs. When that happens, don't view that you're losing your faith. And just view it as, you know, I need to talk to someone. So have a confidant. Every wise person has at least one counselor, one advisor. And Matthew, Pamela, the same thing. Don't just try to be brave without Jehovah, his spirit, and the brotherhood, because it'll help you in the days to come. Because we long to see Jay, maybe not as much as you, but we long to see him living again, serving Jehovah with us. Now, Sharon wanted to conclude the discourse with a kingdom song. You'll hear the music, and then on both of the screens, you'll see the words. So if you would like, you could stand if you wish, and then we'll conclude with a song and then a prayer. But again, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
Holy Father Jehovah, in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Redeemer, we thank you very much for the resurrection hope. It keeps us glued together with our past because we know we don't dwell on the past. Our lives are set toward the future. And we want to live our lives now in a way that will bring you honor by helping others to come to know you better and by seeing that, helping them see that you're a marvelous God. Thank you for the life record of Brother J. Moellendorf. He helped us, Jehovah, in many ways. And surely you'll miss his prayers. You'll miss his activity that he did in behalf of you and the kingdom and your son. And you'll miss the looking at the fine way he cared for his family. But we know for you it won't be long. You'll bring him back to life like you've promised. We have confidence in that, Jehovah, because of our faith and trust in your word. You're not a liar. You're a God who speaks truth. And so we look forward to that glorious day when not just Jay, but faithful ones and unfaithful ones come back to have another opportunity to get it right. So please, Jehovah, have mercy on us. Have mercy on the Moellendorf family, too. They need your help. They need your comfort. So give them your Holy Spirit, please, in a powerful way. And please, dear God, may we support them, too. Thank you very much for the ransom sacrifice of your dear son. And we say this prayer asking forgiveness for our sins. In Jesus' name, amen. And the family wanted us to make one last announcement. Rather than being able to associate here at the Kingdom Hall, they would like to invite all who can, everyone who can, to please come to the Hong Kong buffet. I'm assured that everybody knows where it is. So if you would, please come, and we'll have more association there if you wish. That's an invitation from the family. So please accept it if your circumstances allow. And again, thank you for coming.